إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونصلي ونسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praise due to Allah. We praise Him and we love Him and we seek the help from Him. Whomever Allah guide, no one misguide Him. And whomever misguided, no one will guide him. I bear witness and I believe there is no worthy to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Almighty. And Muhammad is the last and final messenger. قال تعالى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. حَيَاتُ الصَّحَابِيَاتِ, the life of the companion of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the female side. نِسَاءُ الصَّحَابَ, the wife of the companion of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مِنْ خَيْرِ الْبَشَرِ, from among of the best women. Their story is so amazing. They changed the history. They helped the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ in da'wah and in sacrifice and in jihad and every aspect of life. As we have men among of the people of Jannah, we call them al-ashara al-mubashshirin bil-jannah, 10, the one Rasul ﷺ told them or give the guaranteed, that Jannah guaranteed for them. Also among of the female from the Sahabiyat radiyallahu anhum, some of them that Rasul promised for them, promised them that the Jannah is guaranteed to them. Among of them, Umm Sulaym Ar-Rumaysa. This Sahabiyah radiyallahu anha, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith that Nabi Sallam, he said, I enter the Jannah and I hear the sound of walking of Ar-Rumaysa. The footstep of Ar-Rumaysa, Umm Sulaym, in Jannah. What an amazing virtue for this woman. Umm Sulaym, her name is Umm Sulaym Ibnt Malhan, Ukhtu Umm Haram. Umm Sulaym بنت ملحان أخت أم حرام, the sister of أم حرام. And she is the mother of the companion, amazing and famous companion. You know whom? Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنها. She is the mother of Anas bin Malik رضي الله عنها. The one she came and she offered her son to be a slave and servant. To whom? To the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Can you imagine how difficult when you bring your son or daughter and say, you are the servant to that person? But she do it to be whom? To be serve whom? The messengers of Allah. The final messenger. The best person whom walk over this earth. Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umm Sulaym, she loved her deen. She loved the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She loved Islam. She sacrificed her life for Islam. When we are talking about Umm Sulaym, we are talking about a woman. She has a wisdom. When we are talking about Umm Sulaym, we're talking about a woman. She has a deen and faith and belief and strength in her iman and her belief. When we are talking about Umm Sulaym, we talk about the faqiha, alima, scholars in Islam, scholars in deen. When we are talking about Umm Sulaym, we're talking about amazing woman. She has a wisdom and sabr, patient. And now, later on, we will hear some amazing story. Amazing, beautiful, beautiful stories happen with this amazing woman. The one, the Jannah guaranteed for her by the saying of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Umm Sulaym. Ar-Rumaysa, she has a nickname, Ar-Rumaysa. Umm Sulaym Ar-Rumaysa, she become a Muslim during the Mecca time, in the period of Mecca. Her husband, remain in kufr and he doesn't want to be a Muslim. Then they migrate to Medina with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they arrive Medina, she said, "I become a Muslim and I want to follow Islam." And she started teaching her son Anas Islam, and he was angry from her, said, "What? You teaching him this sabati? It's a different religion, it's a different way of life." She said, "No, I fix him, I give him the good education, good information which can benefit him and save him and protect him." Then the husband get mad and angry, and he decide, he asked her, "Come with me to Sham, to Syria. I'm moving there. I don't want to stay in Medina. I don't want to stay with a Muslim." She reject to follow him, and then he left her. And he, while he's going in the way, I mean, a person, he was enemy to him, he killed him, and he died in the state of kufr. So she become a widow, and I mean, and she has only a son, his name Anas bin Malik radiyallahu anha. From here, from this story, we see how much she has a faith. Although her husband, the father of her child, I mean, the one she lived with him for long, when you come across of faith and belief, no, there is nothing higher than my belief towards Allah. Nothing higher than to declare my iman and my faith. So we see the sabr, the patience. Although she knew that she going to be a widow, or she will be alone with one young child, and she is alone, she still remain in her faith. Umm Sulaym, wise woman, nice, amazing akhlaq, beautiful. The man start competing, asking her hand. Many men came and asked her hand. There is no success. Until Abu Talha. Abu Talha, he was a businessman. And he was a strong man. He was a man, real man. Very good akhlaq. Strong, can protect. Wealthy, has money. All the women, they are dreaming that to marry from him. But he went to Umm Sulaym and he asked her hand. He left all the women, the young, whatever, virgin. He went to Umm Sulaym because this woman is unique. And Abu Talha was kafir, not Muslim. And in that time, still not yet the ruling come down or revealed down that the Muslimah not allowed to marry non-Muslim. Although it's halal, not haram, Umm Sulaym, she said, "No, I will reject." She said, "Why? Why you reject? A person wealthy, have money, strong, even Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said his voice in the war better than 1,000 warrior, Abu Talha. Amazing the person. He's unique in strength, in wealth, in etc. In stats." She said, "No, I will reject, but I have offer to you." Said, "What?" "If you become a Muslim, that is my mahar. This is my sadaq, my mahar, my dowry. I don't want any money, I don't want any house, I don't want any gold. If you become a Muslim, this is my mahar." And subhanallah, and she started giving him amazing da'wah. She said, "How? Oh Abu Talha, you are a wise person. You worship that idol. Who made it? Your slave and your servant shape it for you. Then you call that is God, and you call that idol when you are in situation or problem. And if you take that wood, because they used to make the idol from wood or clay, and that wood, if you throw in fire, you burn your own God." She started giving him a da'wah with reflect his mind to that. To see the tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Talha said, "Okay, give me a time." he went and he think deeply, then he understand that what she said is really makes sense. Because at that time, those people, they doesn't have a nifaq or hypocrisy. Yeah, for purpose of marriage, yes, I am a Muslim. Ashhadu la ilaha illallah Muhammad. No, not because of you I will be a Muslim. Because I believe that Islam is a true religion, a true way of life. And look at our time, there is a lots of stories that the marriage did not success because there is no a true belief when they come to marry each other. There is interest. The girl, she says, Ashhadu la ilaha illallah Rasulullah, khalas, I want to marry him. And she doesn't think about his iman or he is really believe in what he's saying. Or maybe a person, he like a girl, she is not Muslima. Okay, Ashhadu la ilaha illallah. Okay, I say, get the money, all right, be married. This is different about their life. They really declare the word of Shahadatan, the gate and the door to enter Islam. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Then Abu Talha came and he said, Ummu Sulaym, I become a Muslim. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And they married, subhanAllah, and they become amazing couple between Ummu Sulaym wa Abu Talha radiyallahu anhu. This couple, they married. Allah bless Abu Talha from Umm Sulaym with amazing son. Handsome, good. And they named that son Umair. And Umair, it has a very nice story. That young son, he used to have a bird. And he used to play with that bird. Then suddenly the bird after time died. So the young child, he felt so, sad that he lost his own bird. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he used to see Umair, he said, Umair, assalamu alaikum, ya Umair, ماذا فعل النغير? Nughayr, the name of his bird. He named him Nughayr. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he used to smile and make him laugh. He said, oh Umair, what happened to the Nughayr? Oh Umair, what happened to the Nughayr? Ya Aba Umair, ماذا فعل النغير? Then he said, Ya Rasulullah, he died. Then Nabi Sallam smiled. Look at the way of Nabi Sallam talking to the young children. Laugh and smile to them. Show them how close to them. This is how should we. Sometimes we ignore the child. Don't talk, he's still young or still boy. No! This is not the right way of education. Not the right way of discipline. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam taught Ibn Abbas hadith when he was 6 years old. Can you imagine? Ya ghulam, O young man, احفظ الله يحفظك احفظ الله تجده تجاهك تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة. O young man, know Allah in the ease. Or in easy time, Allah will help you and protect you and save you and be with you when you are in the hardship. How old Ibn Abbas? 6 years old. 6 years old. We learn from that, from this story, that we should take care about the young children. Nothing wrong if you smile and play with them. And talk to them the sidq, the truth. And teach them that you are a man, you are a boy, but you can be a man, can carry responsibility. And also if a girl, teach her that modest and akhlaq and behave. SubhanAllah, make her love. Al-haya min ad-deen. Also, let's continue this amazing story happened. I don't know how to deliver to you. Because something over our imagination. Umm Sulaym, she has a beautiful, handsome, young son. And Abu Talha only has this son. One time, that son become very sick. SubhanAllah, they try, the father take care about him, give him medicine, take care every day, worried about his own son. That's only one son. When he left for work or in need, SubhanAllah, the woman with the Umm Talha helping her for to treat her son because he's sick. Suddenly the son died between her hand, the hand of Umm Sulaym. Can you imagine, mother, her son died between her hand and young child. Can you imagine? Very young. I don't think so more than 10 years old, according to the narration, because when we call ghulam, the ghulam of the period between 6 to 10, like that. And she knew how much Abu Talha loved his own son, is the only one. What she did to do? Can you imagine a heart of the mother, what will happen in this situation? They start crying, the woman crying. Then the mother, she said, please stop crying, you go home. And please, if the father come, don't inform him that your son died. Then the mother, she covered her son, and she went and she cooked, and she prepared the food, and she cleaned herself and prepared herself as a wife should welcome the husband. Abu Talha come. He asked about his son. What happened to my son? She said, he is very quiet. He's not moving. She tried to refer to him as maybe sleeping, relaxed. That's what he understand. But in the fact, she referred that he left the dunya. Said alhamdulillah. Then she gave him the food and she prepared the food and he eat. And while the wife, mashallah, prepared, he had a relationship with her in that night. Can you imagine? Something unbelievable. In the morning, she turned to him and she said, "Oh Abu Talha, I would like to ask you your opinion." He said, "What? If a neighbor, our neighbor, borrow something from other neighbor, borrow something, maybe a cup, maybe a plate, maybe something you need, and then later they come back and they ask, we want to return it back to us. Shall they return or not?" He said, "Of course, they must return." And he said, "That your son Allah give it to you as a gift, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took that gift from you, so your son already passed away." The husband shocked. "Why you didn't tell me? How come I have a relationship with you? Subhanallah, this is my son." Then she explained to him. Then he said, "Wallahi, by the name of Allah, I will not, make you beat me in sabr, in patience. You are very patient. You control yourself. I will be more patient than you, and I will control myself. And subhanAllah, I will be sabir, among of the sabireen." And he went, he carried his son in the Salatul Fajr, and they washed him, and they buried him, and they prayed janaza on that young child. And they buried him. And he went and he told the Rasulullah what happened. "Ya Rasulullah, that's what happened to us last night. And this is what happened to with me, with my wife." The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, "Ya Allah, oh Allah, give you barakah in your night, that night, the one you have so much sabr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this hardship and this amazing situation." Suddenly she become pregnant. And she delivered a child. And they brought him to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam took the date and tahniq, we call it tahniq, the sunnah. He used the date, and he used the date in the mouth of that young child. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did dua in the barakah for that young child. He said, "Allahumma barik lahum," and he named him Abdullah. They said that child, he's the most healthiest child among of the children in Medina, with the barakah of the dua of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that Abdullah later on, guess what? He married, and Allah bless him with 10 children. All of them memorized Al-Quran and become imams in Medina of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah, shufu dua, shufu sabr, shufu al-iman bil-qada'i wal-qadr, believe in the destiny. I hear there's a book, Weston, I think, he wrote a book about 7 things how to make your life happy. And that book translated to 40 languages. I forget the title name, the name of the book, but inside the book he said, if the people knew aqidah of the Muslims of al-qada wal-qadr, I will not write my book. He's not, I don't think so, he's Muslim, but when he read about the aqidah in Muslims, we have a faith in iman and qada and destiny, whatever has happened from Allah, good or bad, and it's good for us, and that is, we're going to get a reward because of that, and you will release all the stressness and worriness and sadness, and you leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that aqidah is enough, I don't need to write my book. And unfortunately, Muslims, they lastly think about their aqidah of al-iman bil-qada wal-qadar. What happened to them? Oh, happened to me, that things. Oh my God, I lost my son. Oh my God, I lost my job. Oh my God, I lost my husband. Oh my God, I always complain. Where's the iman of al-qada wal-qadar? Where, you know, on the highest level, we learn in the some of the ulama books, the highest level of al-iman bil-qada wal-qadar, that means you accept and you smile in the time of hardship. You said alhamdulillah, you pleased alhamdulillah. I hear a story, a person, subhanallah, and that one day, I mean, he had three situation problems. He lost his son, and his leg been cut or something, yeah, cut because of accident, and something else happened to him, and his house burned. He lost his son, he lost his house, and one of his leg been accidents in the same day. And he said, alhamdulillah, ya Allah, if you take one part of my body, I still have four. Two hand and one leg. You take one, no problem. And if you take my child, I still have four. Subhanallah. If you burn my house, I still can make one. Something like that. Subhanallah, shuf hada sabr. Rida, pleased. Allahu Akbar, what kind of level of faith they have? Allah, يعني, we are talking as is something unbelievable belief, unbelievable control, the angerness because of the iman of to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from this story, you understand Umm Sulaim, you understand how much this woman have a sabr and iman and faith, how much she love her husband and she doesn't want to hurt him. How wise women, how to deliver the news. And from there is heaps and a lot of stories, bad story happened because the people deliver the news wrong way. Ah, what's your name? Are you Siti Maria or are you Ummu Muhammad? Yes, I am Ummu Muhammad. Ah, your son had accident and he died. Come and you get to the police station to collect. Many stories, they collapse this family. Because wrong deliver. At least tell, he was in hospital, he admit, but later on, he then slowly, until you tell her that he died. And this is many, many cases, people faint and lost or have a heart attack or something because of we are wrong deliver the message. Look at Umm Sulaim. She delivered the message to the Abu Talha in very, very amazing style. She wait, she controlled, she make him happy, let him eat, enjoy, and she delivered to him wisdom statement that if somebody take something and he want to take it back, you should take it back and you should accept. Then they understand that all this wisdom come from this believer woman. It's really, really amazing way to deliver the right news. Is it make sense or not? Yes. And subhanAllah, last time a person, he said about cases come from the police because they said police doesn't care. Hello, your son accident. Hello, your son in something or your daughter. You deliver the news with this way. You lost one of the family, lost maybe heart attack. SubhanAllah. So we have to learn the sunnah of as-salihin, the sunnah of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, sunnah of the sahaba, how to deliver the news step by step or in the better way. Also what we learn from this story, that death is the reality. And as we are Muslim, we have to accept the the written what Allah written. Every person, his life, period of life, or period of time, if the ajal, if the death come to him, he cannot speed it or delay it. فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ الله أكبر. فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ. سبحان الله. From here we learn that death is reality. If you lost any member of your family, have a sabr and speak the right word. Speak the right word. And there's a hadith, amazing reward for the one who has sabr. If a person lost his son or daughter and he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him in amazing reward. And what is better than the reward of Jannah? So from here we learn we have to control and have a sabr and speak only the right statement. Umm Sulaym Ar-Rumaysa, her husband, he went for jihad and fight with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was, as I said in the hadith, his voice better than 1,000 warrior. How about his fight? And in battlefield, Abu Talha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him with the shahada and he become a shaheed. So she become the wife of a shaheed, a wife of the matter, and she was have a sabr, amazing sabr. Sulaym remain radiyallahu anha, and she stay with Haram, one other sahabiya. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because of this woman, her iman and her faith, and her husband, amazing sahabi, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to come and visit her. And usually Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't visit women at all. But Haram wa Sulaym, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam honored them, that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam usually he visit his wife, the house of his wife, and also the house of Sulaym. And when the people ask, why ya Rasulullah, you visit Sulaym and Haram in their house, you just, yani individual, your visit to this kind of house or this kind of family, why? Is any speciality? He said, yes, because her husband being shaheed while he's fighting with me. Abu Talha, he was next to the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, and he became a martyr next to the Rasul ﷺ, and that because he was martyr defending Rasul ﷺ, defending the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because of that, Nabi Sam did not forget, even always visit them. And when he visit them, he do dua to her and to that family, Allahu Akbar, with the barakah and blessing. So Sulaym rahimahullah, may Allah gather us with her in Jannah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he honored her and specialized that he used to visit her. Sulaym rahimaha Allah, may Allah have mercy on her. And Sulaym, she loved the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much. In many ahadith that she used to find anything left over from Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she used to collect. His hair, when the hair, he cut his hair, she used to cut, she used to collect and keep it and protect it. And this is the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is halal. التبرك يعني seek blessing من آثار الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم from whatever from الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم it's halal during his life. Since the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم Allah take him to the inshallah to the next life, we not allowed to do تبرك after that. We only allowed during his lifetime. They used to use his hair. They used to, wherever left from his food, they like to eat. They follow Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whatever left from his drink, they'd like to drink. Even some from his araq, sweat, they used to try to collect and put it in their perfume. They used to try to have barakah أمين تبرك in آثار الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم during his life. But after Rasul Salam passed away, we don't have narration that the Sahaba, they used to do tabarruk with his qabr. We don't, I never read in any narration that Ali radiallahu anhu, or Hassan or Hussein, or Abu Bakr Siddiq, or Umar, or all these great Sahaba, they used to go to qabr Rasul Salam and do tabarruk or wipe their cloth with his qabr. He said, this is a blessing. No, this is from the act of bid'ah. It's not innovation, it's not the way of the sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So tabarruku fi hayatihi yajuz. It's unlawful. But tabarruku ba'da mamati Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not lawful. And we don't want any philosophy talk. They say, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still alive. Yes, we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save and protect his body. And he's still, that when we say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah inform him that our salah to him. But we're not allowed, we don't have any narration to do tabarruk in his qabr, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're allowed to visit and give salam to him, but we're not allowed to do tabarruk from the haya, qabr Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So from here we understand that Umm Sulaym, she loved the Islam and loved the messengers of Islam in the way that her iman full, her heart full of iman. And she was among of the people مبشرين بالجنة, glad tidings to them that Jannah. Umm Sulaym رضي الله عنها, may Allah bless her. Umm Sulaym, she narrates hadith from Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, and she has some of a hadith, and she was faqiha. She used to teach the other women's the fiqh, the knowledge of Islam, and she was a da'iyah calling to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she was a wise person until the last day from her life when she died, and she met Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the time of Muawiyah bin Sufyan. She lived longer life after the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she died in the time of Muawiyah. Umm Sulaym radiyallahu anha al-Rumaysa radiyallahu anha, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with her in Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach us the right way of sabr, teach us the right way of faith, right way of iman, right way of sacrifice, right way to love the deen of Allah in passion, love the messengers of Allah in passion, love the seeking knowledge with a passion, love to deliver the message with a passion, love our kids and children with a passion, and we try our best to teach them the goodness and the rightness and the way of life and Islam in order to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Teach us a lesson that how she went and she said, my son Anas, servant to you, Ya Rasulullah. And he served Rasul some 9 years, and he said, I served 9 or 10. He said, hadith, I served Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never said to me, why you did this and why you did that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Anas bin Malik, Rasulullah did dua to him, did dua to him until he lived long life. And some of the people said he's one of the last Sahaba, he died. Anas bin Malik radiyallahu anhu. Allah bless this family. Allah bless Anas bin Malik. Allah bless his mother because of the iman. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless Abu Talha, the husband of Umm Sulaym radiyallahu anhum. What an amazing family. What an amazing family, sacrifice for Allah, and surely they will meet together in Jannah, and the dunya already gone, and the life already gone, and what Allah prepared for them, something so beautiful. Her husband Shaheed, also his Jannah, the Jannah guaranteed for him. Her son, one of the amazing Sahabi, narrated so many hadith, so many hadith. Al-Mukthirun min al-Sahaba, the one he narrated so many hadith, accounted 7. One of them Anas bin Malik, Abu Huraira, وعائشة رضي الله عنها وجابر رضي الله عنه وأنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه وعبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه وعبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنه. And some of those is one of the most of صحابة narrate حديث. أنس بن مالك, her son, one of them. What an amazing family. The family of knowledge, the family of علم, the family of أخلاق, the family of sacrifice. May Allah gather us. Why this? Because of this mother, because of this woman, because of this amazing woman, she draw a golden way, or she draw a gold, sorry, she draw a gold's goals and she sacrificed her life until she achieved her goals. Al-Jannah, Jannatun, Arduha al-Samawat wal-Ard, Uiddat lil-Muttaqeen. Ameen, Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. May Allah bless us, may Allah gather us with her in Jannah. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Wajazakum Allahu khayra, wa ahsan Allahu ilaykum. May Allah bless you, may Allah teach us what is the right for us. Jazakum Allahu khair. صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا. We have a time for question. If you have any question to share with us, جزاكم الله خيرا. Or any comment or any add, so we can beautify this learned lesson from this story. بارك الله فيكم.
Ya Ustaz, Umm Sulaim also narrated a lot of hadith.
Not so much, but she has some hadith. lots of Sahaba, they were memorized so many hadith, but not narrate a lot. Like Abu Bakr Siddiq, he knows so many hadith, but he did not narrate. Some of Sahaba, they work hard for this. They wrote, they live longer life, they teach so many, like Anas bin Malik, Abu Hurairah, live long life. So they narrate and they wrote and they take care about a hadith. So every person, he's unique in the field. But doesn't mean she doesn't know. Doesn't mean Abu Bakr Siddiq doesn't know a hadith, only Abu Hurairah. No. That's what I mean. Narration, specialized in narration of a hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Anas bin Malik, a lot. Majority of the young men or women narrate a lot, such as Aisha, such as Ibn Abbas, such as son of Umar, Abdullah bin Umar, such as all young boys, young girls, they learn, they memorize, and they live longer life, and they deliver. So the hadith, most of this tabi'een, the follower of Sahaba, receive from them and carry on the hadith. And Allah knows the best. Jazakum Allah khair. Barakallahu feekum. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima kathira.